Good afternoon and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Dan Malthrop, Chief Executive here and a proud member. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Carolyn Woo, President and CEO of Catholic Relief Services. She's going to discuss how business can be a force for good. Over the last 2 weeks, our Friday Forum has featured speakers who are thinking very deeply about poverty. Last week, Wall Street Journal columnist and Fox News contributor Jason Riley laid out a case for why the policies of the Great Society era have ultimately failed to alleviate the poverty of the black underclass. Riley, who is African American, titled his talk and his book, "Please Stop Helping Us." The week before that, our forum featured Marion Wright Edelman, president and CEO of the Children's Defense Fund. It was a pretty different talk from Riley's. She argued here, as she has done from our podium before and around the nation as well, for a realignment of existing policy to address longstanding issues of child poverty and family poverty. Indeed, she argued for more government resources to be spent on health care, on housing, and education for our nation's neediest. And though we hadn't initially planned for this to be the case, sometimes we just, you know, you just hit it and you just got to go with it. Three speakers over three Fridays addressing poverty. Our speaker today will offer a third and very different perspective on how we might address the needs of what our mayor calls the least among us. Carolyn Woo leads an international organization devoted to addressing those needs. Catholic Relief Services was founded in 1943 by the Catholic bishops of the United States to serve survivors of World War II in Europe. Since then, it has expanded to reach more than 100 million people in nearly 100 countries on five continents. In an interview with Forbes.com, Dr. Woo referred to the organization as, quote, the best-kept secret of the Catholic Church. Dr. Woo joined Catholic Relief Services in January 2012. In 2013, she was featured in Foreign Policy magazine as one of the 500 most powerful people on the planet and one of only 33 in the category of, quote, a force for good. There's something wrong there. Something else wrong there is that only 10% of those on the list of 500 were women. Prior to her appointment with Catholic Relief Services, and this is where she gets her unique perspective on business as a force for good, Dr. Woo had a distinguished academic career, serving most recently as Dean of the University of Notre Dame Mendoza College of Business for 17 years. Dr. Woo was also the first female dean to chair the accreditation body for business schools, the Association to Advance Collegiate Schools of Business, otherwise known as AACSB, and direct its initiative for peace through commerce. Dr. Woo was born and raised in Hong Kong, immigrated to the United States to attend Purdue University, where she received her BS, or MSIA, and PhD degrees, and became a member, ultimately, of its faculty. Ladies and gentlemen, members and friends of the City Club of Cleveland, please join me in welcoming Dr. Carolyn Woo.
Thank you very much, Dan, and thank you very much for making me a part of history of this wonderful club, the City Club of Cleveland. I feel so honored to be a part of this free speech tradition. Today, my topic is indeed business as a force for good. However, I'm going to begin with a little Jeopardy-like exercise. You are to come up with the question, and I'm going to give you three clues. The three clues are, it is not okay, it is our problem, and we can solve it. So what is extreme poverty? So the question is, what is extreme poverty? So it was in the introduction, so great. I'm glad you listened to Dan. So there is, first of all, a official definition of what is extreme poverty. In the world of development and government, it is defined as $1.25 a day or less. So this is people's income, $1.25 a day or less. Currently, there is about 1 billion out of 7 billion people in the world who is living at that particular standard. So the question is, it is not okay. Why? I would just say morally, it is not okay. Spiritually, it is not okay. And pragmatically, it does not work. There will be consequences. Why is it our problem? It is our problem because we are a human family. We are highly interdependent. Our actions have consequences, and then the consequences also have consequences for us. So there are these feedback loops working so that extreme poverty that now exists in one place in the world, there will be ramifications for all of us. The most important question is really the third one, when I said we can solve it. How are we going to go about and to solve it? And so here I want to present business as one of the solutions. I know development is another one of those solutions. Government policies, for example. You have other speakers have spoken about those too, actually. So today I'm going to present the role of business as a solution. I want to say, first of all, the World Bank itself has defined two primary goals and gotten the support and the approval of all of its member countries. So the two major goals, one is to end extreme poverty, which is defined by bringing the percentage down from about currently 12% to 3% by 2030. That's only 15 years ago away, and we're talking about a pretty drastic reduction from 12 to 3% in 15 years. The second goal it has is to track the income of the bottom 40th percentile of people. And it's a concern about unequal development, development which is not inclusive. So it becomes important to track the bottom 40% to make sure that it grows at least as fast as, if not faster, than the country as a whole. Those are the two primary goals of the World Bank. Now, cross-cutting both of those goals are two issues which are very important. One is the whole issue of peace and the issue of women having access to opportunities, education, and so on. But we don't want to achieve growth if it creates more conflict. The second under cross-cutting theme would be environmental sustainability. So that gives you a sense of just on a global level, the type of conversation which is going on about the issue of extreme poverty. I would say that there is real commitment. I think that is broad also in terms of ownership for this goal, but I don't live in a fantasy world. There will be competing priorities and so on, but at least from the global community basis, there is this desire to end extreme poverty. People say, how will this work? The World Bank did some scenario analysis, and one of the scenario is that if the countries can grow at 4% a year, maintaining the same income distribution, it would be able to arrive at that goal. So if you're able to raise the bottom faster, then you'll be able to get done faster. If the growth is higher than 4%, maintaining the same level of proportion of income distribution, we will get to that goal faster. Instead of 4%, it's only 3%, but we pay more attention to the income of the lowest 40th percentile, it could also get there. But that gives you a sense of sort of, it is not an easy goal, a 4% growth, but it is not also a fantasy goal, all right? So here is a bit of that sense. Now, 4% growth requires economic activities. It just can't grow by itself. And so we need to have economic activities. Just to give you some sense, the emerging markets or the developing markets, or if you're aware of, actually are projected to grow quite fast. The projection is that 50% of the GDP growth from now till 2030, actually the 50% of that growth will come from about 440 cities in developing countries that most people have not heard of those cities. So Tianjin in China, or Porto Alegre in Brazil, Kumasi in Ghana, Hsinchu in Taiwan. I mean, these are not cities that roll off the top of your tongue, but 440 cities in emerging countries, they will account for 50% of the GDP growth in the world going forward. So there's actually a lot of activities in developing countries. There's also a projection that companies from these emerging markets, which now account for about 5% of the Fortune Global 500, will actually move to over 40% of the global Fortune 500. So there are a lot of activities which are going on in the developing countries. So I just want people to know it. Aid is still necessary, but the future of these countries does not just depend on aid. It's how we use aid actually to be able to leverage and allow people to participate in growth. I want to tell you a few stories today because people told me that stories is how people absorb a message. This story is actually the major actor in it is Ben Affleck and Jennifer Garner. Ben Affleck recently did a congressional testimony, and Jennifer Garner was sitting behind him. So it was a 7-minute clip, actually, where he talked about his initiative in East Congo. He works, his nonprofit works in the East Congo to help farmers become productive in coffee production. The reason is that coffee production in the East Congo now is only about 10% of what it used to be. So violence and different disasters have caused the country actually to lose its production base. And in order to bring a country back to prosperity and, more important, to peace, it is important to have productive activities. So the East Congo Initiative focuses on farmers and also to help them expand their production and recover so that they could go to achieve a better way to make a living. His East Congo Initiative is actually supported also by USAID, by the Howard Buffett Foundation. CRS is actually an implementation partner because you have to do a lot of work to help farmers transform. And Starbucks is at the end of this to buy the coffee. All right. So you see this, how this works and why business is necessary, because if there's nobody to buy the coffee, all of this work is in vain. And around the world, this type of model, which is how do we enhance the livelihoods of farmers by introducing new products to plant, new ways of planting and growing, new ways to conserve the soil, new ways to anticipate climate change, for example, is really happening. But for all of these, we need to have businesses, we need to have food processors, food retailers involved. And we're talking about a cacao in addition to coffee, cashews, vanilla, passion fruit, whatever it is that you can think about in multiple continents, in Asia, in Africa, in Central America. So that gives you a sense. I also want to give you another story, and here is sort of thinking about East Congo farmers and Ben Affleck's work. I want to give you the picture of one specific farmer, because sometimes it's the story of one person that really touches us. And I'm going to tell the story of Ernesto in Nicaragua. My husband and I actually visited there, and he now could tell the story too. Quite amazing. Ernesto, like a lot of the farmers in Nicaragua, have very small farms. These are mostly ancestral plot sometimes, or some government land reform program where everybody is given a few acres. Seldom does the farm exceed 5 acres. So you're talking about very, very small farms. Ernesto, like his grandfather, his father, and all of his neighbor, grows maize. The fact that he can't really sell the maize because everybody around him also grows maize has not caused a change in the other products, because they actually don't know what else to grow and how to grow it. Ernesto got to the point that whenever he heard a motorcycle, he would go and hide. And the reason is that only bank loan collectors have motorcycles. He was in so much debt because every season when he borrowed money to buy seeds and fertilizers and so on, he was not able to grow enough to recover the cost. And so he was getting deeper and deeper in debt. He was about to lose his farm. Once he loses his farm, he would really have no place to sleep except at the charity of others. He will become a day laborer. He will go from farm to farm to seek work. He had two children who were in high school. They would have to drop out because there would be no tuition. So Ernesto was hiding from the bank collectors. At that point, he saw advertisement for a project, a big project, actually, that CRS and the consortium was promoting. And that was, we will work with farmers for the first year to convert them to a new crop and to stay with them and help them achieve success. Mostly in the first year, very intense mentoring and technical assistance. Ernesto signed up. The new crop that he would be growing was passion fruit. And all of you know you can buy passion fruit juice and so on in our grocery stores. It's a big export fruit, actually. So Ernesto started doing this. He had no idea what to do. The first year, seed was provided to him for free and a lot of technical assistance helping him grow passion fruit. He did well. The first year, he made enough money to do two things, to retire his debt and also to have money to buy seeds for the next season. He went into the next season. He did even better. And then he had an idea for the third season, and that is the yield that he was getting was not as high as he would like it to be. And in order to get it higher, he thought he could start a greenhouse. And so that allowed the seeds to germinate in a protected environment, for the seed to grow to about 3 or 4 inches, and then he will plant it in a field, and that yield actually exceeded 90% from 70%. So it was the whole idea now of making an investment in a greenhouse. It's a business analysis, investing in a greenhouse and having a higher yield. He decided to do that, and because he had the greenhouse, he also had additional capacity for his farmer neighbors. So he started taking in other people's seeds and germinating in his greenhouse. The next thing he realized was that he needed a medium, a soil, for his greenhouse. And the soil had to be nutrient-rich and also free of bacteria. And so he wondered where he would get that, and he incented the women in his community to start a business. And in this case, the business entails the women collecting cow dung from the field, which was a waste product, and they use this materials and put it into vats of soil, huge vats of soil, to encourage earthworms to grow, and the earthworms will aerate the soil, and it became very rich medium. So here was another business, which was the production of the medium for the germination of the seeds. And then Ernesto became confident. He decided to take a course and be certified on the use of chemicals. He then knew enough that the fertilizer companies were overselling him and his farmer neighbors, that they would become indebted for a product that actually hurt the land, and he became certified and told them that he no longer needed their products. Today, Ernesto has two motorcycles. His two children actually now have finished university. One is an agronomist and the other is a soil scientist. Every year he takes in 20 farmers to mentor them in terms of what they should do. So I only tell this story when we say business as a force for good is not just big multinationals. Actually, we need to encourage a lot of small and medium-sized businesses which are local because they know the local culture and they contribute a lot to the local economy. But I also want to highlight the fact that in this case, we now involve export. And there are facilities and infrastructures, export companies, financing for export, and so on and so forth, which are also needed in this equation. And this is also all part of what we call the free market. So the free markets are necessary. Capital markets are necessary. And so I just want to give a sense of this. Why is this work with farmers important? There are only 800 million Ernestos in the world. They tend to be the poorest. They're ones who are subsisting on very little. Ironically, their children are the children who are often malnourished because when you grow maize, that's what you have. And that doesn't make for a fulsome diet. And so it's not only Ernesto's livelihood, but it also affects his children. And as Ernesto's children, if there are four, five children, two, three, whatever it is, there's not enough land for each of those child, which means that it is very important for the children to get education. And when they get education, you can see sort of like the migration of American farm families. The second, third, fourth generations will then be able to take advantage of other opportunities. The fact that if Ernesto loses his land, he sells it to a big co-op or big food retailers, he will move to the city and he will become one of the slum poor. The urbanization of cities is coming very, very quickly, exceeding the rate that cities could take care of these new dwellers. His children will not likely go to school. They will probably become a wandering youth, an itinerant youth. Some of them, many of them, join gangs. Many of them seek migration, legal or illegal. Many of them actually falls into the hands of traffickers. And so if we don't solve the problem at its source, we will basically exacerbate the problem down the way in cities and so on. So this is just one little example of how businesses, the way that it sources its supply chain. For example, how do big companies like Walmart, Cisco, and so on and so forth, Costco, I mean, when they buy bananas, sugar, vanilla, cocoa, coffee, and so on, if they only buy from very large food processors, then these very small farmers will be sort of left out in the chain. And so the work that we do now actually is both from the field in terms of how we work with farmers and so on to make sure that they have the quality, the quantity, the consistency that meets the certification. Because when you buy coffee at Starbucks or Costco, you want to make sure that that coffee is good. So these sellers also need to have certification. So how do you move people through this certification process in order for them to participate in the market? Another example I want to give is our work with youth in Central America. Last summer, you saw a lot of undocumented migrants who were moving through the border. They came through Nicaragua, Guatemala, and so on. And there are a lot of what we call push factors. What were the reasons for their departure? We were just in Guatemala. We met with some of the migrants, those who are on their way north, those who were deported back, and that whole conversation. And it is heartbreaking. We met a man with an 11-year-old, his nephew, and they had to leave because the nephew received one of those standard letters from a gang, which is join or die. And these are common letters. We met a man in his 20s who had been trying to leave since he was 14 years old. And the first time he tried, the coyote said, "I'm going to take you to the United States." They took him across the river between Guatemala and Mexico and dropped him there and made him believe that he was in the U.S. when he was in Mexico. We met a man who broke both of his ankles jumping from some high places. And so the whole question is, why do people choose to do that? I've also been in the border area in McAllen. And they do it for really two big reasons: the lack of economic opportunities and also violence. So in Central America, we do a lot of this agriculture work also to make sure that the rural poor and the farmers, at least that part of it, is being addressed. But we also work a lot with youth. We now have a program. We are passed through our pilot phase, which is 5,000 young people at risk. They're from age 15 to age 25. They're kids who don't have jobs, and some of them actually don't have homes. We work with them through a very extensive program of training, of life skills, as well as vocational skills. It's 400 hours of curriculum. But at the same time, we need companies to be employing them. So it is a program we actually cannot do without business. And so we have over 200 local businesses employing these young people as interns and later on employing them as employees. And this program is also a benefit to businesses because, as you can imagine, they need a good workforce. And with the issue of gangs and so on, it's difficult to have access to certified employees. So they're participating. I'm happy to report that for that program is an 85% success rate, which means that the young person either goes back to school, has a job, or starts a small business. We're now moving to the next stage of 10,000 youth. Eventually, is to take it national and into multiple countries. So I just want to say, and I want to also tell a story of abuse. About business and what we can do about that. And that is when I went to an East Africa country. I love flowers. I love arranging flowers. I thought the best thing that ever happened was long stem roses by the bundles of 20 started appearing in big box retailers for about $15. For like $15, you could buy a big bouquet of roses and so on. And it just really allowed me to do a lot of flower arrangements. When I went to East Africa, I went to one of these flower farms. They're actually long rows of plastic enclosed greenhouses. And what I found from that was that the rate of cancer was very high for the workers of those flower greenhouses. And the reason was that the enclosure by plastic, the sun, together with the use of fertilizers and pesticides, created a lot of toxin. So people breathing in those that air and so on and so forth experience a higher rate of cancer, and also the flower farms sucked up so much water that it caused the water table to dry up for the farmers. And so this is not a long-term solution. I came back and told my husband, please start planting some flowers because I couldn't buy them anymore. But I couldn't bring myself to buy flowers after I knew what it took at the other end in terms of the type of practices. But I just want to say there are solutions to that. The country next door to this particular country had much higher regulations for the flower farms. So they have regulations relating to the ventilation of that facility. They have regulations for breaks when people need to leave and go out. They have provisions for testing for the employees, and also they require water recycling so that there is not the same draw from the local water tables. I show all of this is because, number one, business activities, there was a calculation, business, government, and development combined, business level of activities is like 5 out of 6 parts. So if we don't know how to access that scope of activities, we would not be able to come up with the solutions. The second thing is that unless we could create employment for people or markets for people's products, then we could not solve the problem of poverty. I want to say that overall business nowadays, they're both internal and external improvements. Internal, they say millennials care a lot more about meaning and purpose and fairness in the way they consume product and in the companies that they choose to work for. Overall, there's a lot more attention to triple bottom line, which looks at not only dollar gains, but also benefits to society and the environment. There are also more governance in terms of board committees, which look at that. Externally now, there are just, like I said, a new generation of consumers who care about these things. There's also the competition part of it, and then I think people try to be greener, try to be more responsible, at least in reputation, than their competitors. But overall, there's also, I think, increased governance in terms of government regulatory system, in terms of civil watchdogs. There are agencies which do that, but most important, social surveillance of that behavior. So I just want to end by saying that there's a lot of not-so-good things that business does, but the idea is to remember that business itself and markets, they are tools They're neither good nor bad, but it depends on the moral energy of the people who lead it and the people who run it. And if there is the right moral energies, there are so many opportunities. And the bottom line is that we need to use our imagination and call for accountability for business to be a necessary good and not a necessary evil. Thank you.
Today, we are enjoying a Friday forum featuring Dr. Carolyn Woo, President and CEO of Catholic Relief Services. We encourage you to organize your questions for our speaker now and remind you that your questions should be brief and to the point. We welcome all of you here and those joining us via our primary media partner, 90.3 WCPN, WVIZ PBS, 104.9 WCLV IdeaStream, or one of the many radio stations across the region and country that carry City Club programs. Television broadcasts of the City Club are made possible by PNC and Cleveland State University. Our live webcast is supported by the University of Akron. Be sure to join us next Friday, June 12th, as we welcome Tom Zenti, CEO of University Hospitals, for a conversation on the future of healthcare in Northeast Ohio. Also, we are pleased to announce the City Club will welcome Chair of the Federal Reserve, Janet Yellen, on July 10th. For more information about any of our upcoming programs, please visit us online at cityclub.org. Today's forum is the Paul A. and Sonia F. Unger International Forum on Cleveland in the World, made possible by a generous endowment gift from Paul and Sonia Unger. We thank you very much for your support. And our community partner for today's program is Cleveland Catholic Charities Migration and Refugee Services. We thank you very much for your support. Additionally, we welcome guests at tables hosted by the Diocese of Cleveland Social Action Office. We thank you very much for your support. Now it's time to return to Dr. Woo for our traditional City Club Q&A. We welcome questions from everyone, members and guests alike. Holding our microphone today is our Associate Director of Advancement, Mike Grimaldi. Our first question, please.
Yes, ma'am. Would you say that our current immigration policies are helping, hurting, or have no effect on what you're trying to do?
Well, first of all, our current immigration policies is a bit chaotic and disjointed. And so there was a sense that last year's surge was motivated by an interpretation of misinterpretation of the ease of being able to stay in the United States after people make it through the border. So there was sort of maybe an interpretation of policy that triggers certain action. But the bottom line really is we have to deal with the push factors of these countries. Why do people choose to leave and to take such perilous journeys and to wager their whole life savings in order to do this? So that's why we focus our work a lot on improving the conditions relating to poverty and hopefully relating to violence and allowing people more options than just to leave.
Good afternoon. I love the term moral energy. And when you talk about companies like Walmart, I think they're lacking in moral energy. So how would you incentivize a large company like Walmart to begin to buy from the smaller farms and businesses?
So first of all, a couple of statements. Companies in the end are made up of people. From the top down, they're all made up of people. The second thing is that the past reputation of a company, whether it is in the 70s, the 80s, sometimes may not be where they are today. For example, Nestle with the baby formula issue, Nike with the labor issue, and Walmart with its various labor issues. So I would say nowadays Walmart actually does start buying from these small farmers. It takes a lot of work. I mean, it's not just on Walmart's part, but how do we engage farmers in large numbers to the point where their products are of the quality and the quantity and the consistency that you buying at Walmart will actually be pleased with. So actually, there's been a lot of work on the part of Walmart. Can it do more? Absolutely. It has made up some public commitment in terms of, for example, buying from 1 million farmers, smallholder farmers, rather than large retailers. So companies across the world now, it's not unusual if you go to Starbucks or Target, whatever, they will have a brochure that talks about their corporate social responsibility, and that is no longer about philanthropy. It is no longer about giving money away, but it's actually within the operations of what we call the value chain of a company. How is it rethinking how those different steps are to be conducted and from where they should buy their inputs in a way that could benefit the people at the bottom of society as well as and the environment and so on. So I just want to say large companies, they're so complex, there's hundreds of thousands of employees and so on and so forth. They could never be perfect. But the question is, at the top level, is there a recognition of the potential of what can be done, and also is there follow-up programs and metrics, for example, to get that work done. A number of the very large companies now are part of what is called the UN Global Contract, Compact, the UN Global Compact, which calls, if you're a member, you volunteer to be a member. You are not forced to be a member. But once you're a member, you have to put out a report, a communication of progress along 10 dimensions in terms of how you're progressing on those dimensions. And it deals with labor rights, human rights, environmental sustainability, refraining from using slave labor, for example. And so there are now these public reports. And once the company puts out a public report, actually there's accountability.
Dr. Woo, thank you so much for joining us at the City Club. And thank you in particular for sharing the stories like that of Ernesto. That was really inspiring. The question that I'm wrestling with is this issue of reduction in extreme poverty and this World Bank notion of between now and 2030, we grow at 4%, we maintain the same income distribution, we're going to get the people from below $1.25 to, let's say, $2.50. But in 2030, maybe that's the extreme poverty level. So isn't it all relative? And especially if we just continue to focus on growth, as opposed to what you've been talking about just now, about focusing on the triple bottom line and value.
So two things. I often said is not no need to write home to anyone that we are reducing the percentage of people living at $1.25. That's not wealth by any stretch. There are about 2 billion people living at $2 or less, for example. There are some studies that show, and these are not scientific evidence yet, that shows that countries which have income of less than $3,000 per person tend to fall into conflict, that it takes about $6,000 per person in income to have sustainable stability. So $3,000 per person is $10 a day. So just taking people from $1.25 to slightly higher, you're absolutely right. That is not good enough. But we need to start somewhere. If we don't even commit to that, we're not going to commit to a lot of things. And I think as a result, therefore, tracking the bottom 40th percentile's growth in income is very important so that they're not left behind. So the question is, should we focus on growth in income? Aren't we in some ways an over-consuming world already? I would say if you look at Western developed countries, I would say if you look at the United States, we definitely overconsume. If we look at these countries that I'm talking about, 80% of poverty is in sub-Saharan Africa. They need to grow their income. They're not really at the level where their lives are really working. So different parts of the population.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Woo. Do you believe President Obama when he says the Trans-Pacific Partnership is good for our country and other member countries?
I have not followed enough about that trade pact. I think the devil is in details, and there's a lot of details that we don't know.
Part of the fun of listening to someone with your perspective is sifting through your remarks for what feels like a new transformative idea. I can remember the first time somebody really drove home to me that if you get women to think of themselves as learning machines. They will come up with loads of alternatives, and you'll get a transformation of the society in which they live. And in listening to your remarks, the thing which jumped out at me is a somewhat new thought, is to go to a subsistence farmer and say, I want you to become aware of the export market, that it's not just selling the thing that you've always sold down the at the local village market, but there is a world beyond for which you may have a chance to contribute, to which you can contribute. Is that, in fact, a transformative idea in the world that you have been working in?
Absolutely. The journey for a farmer to go from Ernesto to selling to Walmart, for example, Ernesto learned fast, but I would say it took him about 2 years where he could completely fly on his own. The first year, he was definitely with us. We provided the seed, the technical assistance, our technical people, field people went and visited often. Second year, we were still working with him. It takes about 3 years. And in dealing with this type of transformation, you're often also working with people who are not literate. And there are a lot of concepts embedded in this change. There's sort of new way of planting, new way of soil conservation to understand the health of a plant, to be able to look at the roots and know what it should look like. I was just there with some farmers, and they showed me healthy and unhealthy roots. And, you know, so that sort of thing. But also numeric literacy, eventually they will be seeking better markets for their products. Ernesto actually learned how to do an investment analysis when he started with the greenhouse. I mean, it may be the simplest business, but he had to ask himself, how much money do I need? How will I get that money? How will I get the return to that money? I mean, that's fairly sophisticated thinking. And now he has actually multiple greenhouses. And for him to think about how to bring other farmers in, there's also a sales message there, too. He had to convince the other people, this is good for you, and make use of his excess capacity. So CRS actually have a very well-developed suite of software called FarmBook that provides multiple dimensions of training, including how do you work together as a co-op? Because, you know, our work, the amount of grants that we won and so on associated with agriculture just last year in 2014 will allow us to work with 35 million farmers over the next 5 years. So you have to think about the scale and how to work with people in scale. So, you know, this whole investment in that farmer in terms of literacy, in terms of investment analysis, in terms of crop analysis, in terms of plant health analysis, using a lot of software and a lot of training. Ernesto also learned how to use chemicals. So think about that whole transformation when Ernesto didn't know anything except maize. Right? So that's a very important transformation. At the same time, too, we're also introducing other services to Ernesto's family. So nutrition, for example, because they tend to be monocrop, they eat what they grow. And so eating a lot of maize does not allow for a healthy diet. So the whole idea of how to diversify their diet, teaching young mothers and lactating mothers and expecting mothers what type of nutrition they need, making sure that there is tuition also for the children to go to school. Latin America has a very strong value, actually, for education, to make sure that that happens. It's a complete transformation. I would say there is some debate on whether what would be the impact of working with a lot of small farmers? Because in the end, isn't it more productive, for example, to have very large farms, you know, where you can apply a lot of equipment, which is the U.S. model of farming. And there are studies that show a correlation between urbanization and prosperity. You can see that was how England developed with industrialization and so on. But the bottom line is that we're not ready for mass urbanization for people to move into the cities because there are no jobs to absorb them. And so we also don't want all the Ernestos to become unemployed. So there is a transition, and particularly we're very concerned about the second generation in terms of their access to education so that they have alternative futures. We are also teaching farm families how to save. because it is too risky to borrow. If you go to the bank and your harvest does not work out, you will lose everything, like Ernesto was about to do. And so the whole idea, if I form a group of 20 women, each of us, you know, say $5 a month or whatever it is, all of a sudden there's a pool of $100. You have access to capital so that you don't have to go to the bank. And so CRS actually sold a lot of our micro lending banks. We started that about 20-some years ago. They're doing very well. They're very steady. We actually gave them to some of our Catholic Church partners. But we are now starting a lot of saving circles. This whole idea of internal savings to access your capital. 2 years ago, we reached 1 million people saving $10 million. And about $9.7 million of it was invested in their own businesses, whether it is buy another acre, buy chicken, buy a goat, start a, you know, donut business, whatever it is. It's really the whole idea of helping people understand what capacity they themselves have and as a community. So it is transformative.
Dr. Woo, you have focused on people who live close to the soil, who are potential in the farming area. But a lot of people have already moved to the cities in increasing numbers and work in the cities in manufacturing of some sort or another for what we would consider starvation wages. How can the people in the cities be helped to bring them potentially out of poverty?
That is an excellent question, because the majority of people in the world live in cities, and the highest growth rate is urbanization in cities. Sirius is just beginning to do more work associated with urban areas. Clearly, over our development life, we worked in rural areas, and now we have this very big push with farmers. Where we have started now with urban areas is, first of all, our youth builder program, starting with the youth. Because of all of this, the difficult migration issues and so on. So we have a model for that. As you can tell, I just said we finished our pilot of 5,000. We're going to the next level pilot at 10,000 before we go national with youth. So we're very young, actually, in that whole area of sort of vocational skills development. There's some religious congregations and actually who are in vocational training. So there's that part of it, and we'll most likely partner with them, but we're just starting. There's a whole area then. Another area is really workers' rights. How do you help workers develop a sense of what their rights are as workers? What type of recourses do they have if they're maltreated? Which government ministries actually should be checking on this? Because in a lot of countries where there is slave labor, there's actually laws against it, but it's just not enforced. So there's a whole area of sort of building the capacity of a community to advocate for itself. We've done some of that, but not a lot of it. But that's an excellent question.
Americans are extraordinarily generous people. We give literally billions a year to various charities. It was very discouraging the other day to hear a report from ProPublica and NPR on the abject failure of the American Red Cross, which raised $500 million for relief in Haiti following the hurricane there, that apparently the majority of that money has simply been wasted. For those of us who do want to support various charities, what recommendations can you give us as to how we can identify what agencies really give you some bang for the buck?
For domestic services, support Catholic Charities. So I just want to say, actually, there are so many new nonprofits which have popped up. They are all sometimes very innovative sounding. They have a few success stories. Here you're dealing with a question of waste. Sometimes there's this question of inefficiency. People don't have the scale to really be efficient. In many situations nowadays, there's also, you start a nonprofit and you say, you know, my job is to help veterans retrain, for example. And then there is a fundraising firm that comes to you and say, we could do fundraising for your cause. We keep 80% and you take 20%. That's not very, very common. And so you actually have these fundraising firms using your particular cause as their way to earn a lot of revenues. So I always say there are various charities that you've given for a long time and continue to support those. If it is a new cause that you have in mind, for example, children who have cancer, whatever it is, you should research it. You should research the organizations. How long has it been around? What is its income statement balance sheet? What is the percentage of revenues that it used to support its overhead costs? And so those type of financial statements are actually available. If they're not available, you should not give to them. Okay, so you want to study new causes, new agencies that you give to. I know Red Cross have a long-standing reputation. Red Cross also has had a lot of scandals along the way.
Oh, thank you. I just wanted to know, Catholic Relief Services works in over 100 countries, in Syria and places like that. I just wanted to know if you could clarify, like, why is this so important to the Catholic Church here in the U.S. related to the mission?
Well, the Catholic faith, you know, caused us to go to neighbors, and it didn't put a creed, a race, a zip code, a country code for what neighbor is. So the gospel basically said, and Pope Benedict in his encyclical, Deus Caritas Est, said, the neighbor is anyone you meet who is in need of help. And so it's the tradition of to go where help is needed, where hope is very much needed, where people are completely abandoned. They live lives that you can't even imagine. Their own safety is always at risk. Their children's survival is not to be taken for granted. I once was with a woman, and here was actually a city, I mean, in Afghanistan, but it was a community, and the women in groups of 20 were trained in terms of business skills. And this particular group of women, very entrepreneurial, after their training, they decided to have a bakery. And we were able to give them a packet of funds that included investment in an oven and also enough raw material, sugar, flour, whatever it is, to last them for 3 months of operations. They sold out in 1 week. And the way they sold out was that they went to the police department and sold them their cookies. So the idea of how police love donuts, you know, in the U.S. I mean, that's how they're portrayed. Well, police love cookies, you know, and in Afghanistan. And I was talking to this woman. She was the lead person. You can tell she was not educated before this training. She was breastfeeding a baby. And I asked her about the baby, and I said, how many children do you have? And she said, my last one died because he didn't have anything to eat. And one of the purpose for this particular business in which she succeeded so well was that she could feed her baby and that she herself have enough nutrient to have the milk to feed the baby. And so I don't know how I got there. Oh, you asked me, why do we do that? Well, we do that because that's what our faith calls. And actually, along the way, I just want to say we run into people of many different faiths. It is a wonderful interfaith collaboration. We've worked with the Islamic Relief Group. We have the Buddhists have supported our work in various countries. We work with the Hindus and so on. So we work and have encountered people of so many different faiths with the same objective, and that is to show up and help when it is needed.
Hi, Dr. Woo. Thank you very much for your talk. It's been wonderful. My question for you is, at a time when charitable organizations and not-for-profits are asked to do more with less, what's your vision for the role of Catholic Relief Services over the next, 10 to 15 years and working towards that, sort of the goals that the World Bank outlined? What's sort of your vision for the role that CRFs will play?
Yeah. So first of all, going back to your point about doing more with less, I like that theory a lot. I think I'm pretty tough business manager. I'm always concerned when people tell me, give me more money and I could do more. I usually say, can you just show me more you can do with the same? Because otherwise we never innovate. We don't change the way we work. And just even the technology that we have, who has a cell phone which is older than 4 years old? There's just almost nobody. And our computers, if it's 7 years, is already limping along. But we never really address the way we do things, the way that we use human resource and so on and so forth, whether that is the best way to use it. And therefore, if we want to do something new, we ask for new money. So I actually like the challenge always, and that is, can you do more with less? And in fact, can you have more impact using the same money that you have? And so for Catholic Relief Services, we believe in several things. We are serving about 85 to 130 million people, averaging around 100 million people per year. We'd like to serve 150 million people because we think that we need to challenge ourselves with some, but not huge growth, and definitely not 50% growth in our resources, to be able to take on that and to be accountable. Thank you. This is a signal. Yeah.
Today at the City Club of Cleveland, we've been enjoying a Friday forum featuring Dr. Carolyn Woo, President and CEO of Catholic Relief Services. Thank you, Dr. Woo.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Our forum is now adjourned.